Thank you. Welcome everyone, this is for eulogy.
Thank you.
You are just the Lord, and your judgment is right. Treat your servant in accord with your merciful love. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. At the gathering of the sacred mysteries, you recognize our sinfulness, but trust in God's mercy. He was sent to heal the contrite, God have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
He came to save sinners, Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, we will fall at the last of night.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, by whom we are redeemed and receive adoption, look graciously upon your beloved sons and daughters, that those who believe in Christ may receive true freedom and an everlasting inheritance. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, of God, and of the temple.
Amen.
Is it for it is?
Thank you.
reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus said to his disciples, "See that you are dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like men waiting for their master to return from the wedding feast, ready to open the door soon as he comes and knocks. Happy those servants whom the master finds awake when he comes. I tell you solemnly, he will put on an apron, sit them down at a table, and wait on them. It may be in the second watch he comes, or in the third, but happy those servants if he finds them ready. You may be quite sure of this, that if the householder had known how the lover the burden would come, he would not have let anyone break through the wall of his house. You too must stand ready, because the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
And about half an hour later, he came came back to life. His recovery was remarkable. Within 2 months or so, he was walking and just recovered at an amazing speed. That was what they could see. But when he started to talk, there was a whole different story that made what they saw pale by comparison. He said he knew he had died, because at a certain point in time, he was hovering over his body on the operating table. He was hovering over, looking down at his surgeons fighting to save him. He even saw where a pen slipped out of the pocket of one of the surgeons and rolled into a corner. And he saw the surgeon searching for this after the whole surgery and not finding it. And he was able to tell him afterwards exactly where it fell. He said after a while, realizing when they stopped fighting that he had died, then he realized, but if that is me, who is this? Then he started for some reason to move out of the room, except when he reached over the door, his hand went through the door. And then he went through the entire wall. And he was walking in the corridor, people were walking into him, and he was cringing, and they walked right through it. It took him a little while to realize that his existence was really his soul. His soul was out of his body, his soul moved out of the room, his soul moved into the corridor, and then after a while, he came back. But not before this happened. He said, while in that corridor, at a certain point in time, he was just made aware of brilliant light. And he was made aware that he was in the presence of God. And without words, God showed him his life. And he showed him all the negative things in his life, especially as a priest for 12 years. And then he understood God saying to him at the end, "You have lived your 12 years of priesthood for yourself, not for me. And your judgment is hell." And all he could do is not in agreement, because nothing God said to him was untrue. Everything God said to him was true. He was not a womanizer, he was not a drunk, he was not into money. He lived a very comfortable, simple, ordinary life. He patterned his life to match the life of the senior priest he was sent to live with. So he was just trying to be a normal priest. But being a normal priest meant that he worked very little as a priest. He had like 3 days off. There was a day for golf, and a day for this, and a day for that. Comfort and luxury, fully air-conditioned, numerous bedrooms, directory, nice fancy car. He lived his life for himself, not for Jesus. And the judgment was held. And then suddenly, when that passed, he had a sense of a sweet feminine voice asking the Lord a question. And the question was, without words, he just knew these things. The feminine voice asked, "Maybe if you grant him enough graces, he could still be saved." And then he felt as though Jesus turned his face away from him. And that's when his soul made its way back into the womb, into his body, and he revived. When he told that story to his parishioners and the priests who lived with him, they were all in shock, because nobody could guess that that priest would ever go to heaven. He was a very nice guy, he lived a ordinary life, he was in no scandal, nothing to point a finger to. His sin was an overall lifestyle that belonged to himself, not to Christ Jesus. A Christian's life does not belong to himself or herself. In baptism, we die with Christ, so that the life we now live belongs not to us, but to him. My life is not my own to be my own man to do things my way. That's wrong. If I were not a baptized person, maybe. But as a baptized person, at baptism, I was handed back to Jesus, and my parents and godparents took the responsibility of raising me to understand and to live my life for Christ Jesus. A baptized person does not own himself or herself. If they truly understand what baptism means, you are not your own, I am not my own. It's not about who I am, it is whose I am that is the important question. Whose I am? I belong to the Lord Jesus because I have been baptized. And if you sing that song, like the kindness of something, there is nothing better that could have happened to any one of us. Nothing better than baptism. Because to be lost in the life of Christ is to truly find yourself. We only find ourselves as we allow ourselves to be given over to Christ Jesus. And nothing about the funeral ceremony affects our judgment. Yet we pray for all our dead that whatever help they may still be able to receive, they will get from us. One way of looking at death is to see that, you know, or life rather, to see the way we live our life kind of corresponds to our understanding of death. So I suppose those who just avoid thinking about death, they just, summarizing, like drift forward, they just drift forward, backward, right, left, side to side, and then you're not so sure where that life is going. When you have no rhyme or reason about your existence, as the hand is swinging. For those who have an understanding of death, that should give us a prescription for life. So the way we understand death, that should give us a prescription for life. So those who believe that you have a countless number of opportunities to be reincarnated over and over and over, for such a person, if this life gets really, really messy and too painful, you can commit suicide because you believe you're going to come back. For those who believe, as Christians do believe, Muslims too, it is appointed once to live this life, to die and be judged, then because there's only one time you get to do this, you're supposed to live your life very, very carefully. You don't want to be looking back 5 years, 10 years ago with regrets, painful regrets. You don't want to reach 80 or 90 and look back at the life and realize I wasted my one life. I have nothing to show for it. I've seen that in faces of some elderly people. You and I do not want to be in that position. It means to say, we have to be very deliberate and very intentional with what we do with this one, with this gift of one life. This gift of one life. Why some people get 50 years, why some get 5 years? Why some get 100 years? All part of God's mystery as to what he designed for us. Some people I knew personally, others I just heard about, had no problem at all with this. I have a priest friend from Ghana, West Africa. He His mother died during this year at 110. And when I met him recently, he said she was never sick. But in the last few months, she kept saying, I'm tired. I knew Bishop Benz for quite a long time, and once he turned about 85, I was living by one of his sisters, and once he felt useless, he started saying things much the same. You know, why is the good Lord keep me here? Where to go? Why is the good Lord take me and where to go? He would say that. He was like, no fear, no trepidation, no anxiety. If we lived our lives, I know it says perfect, but if we lived our lives with a deep intentionality about being this disciple of Christ, death, where is thy victory? Death, where is thy sting? If we have lived, truly lived our lives in the Lord, it will come to its end, and it really doesn't matter, because it will be in the Lord. And it will continue in the Lord. There's a retreat young people in the Catholic Church do, we call it the Carnival Retreat, over the Carnival Weekend. And we teach young people to evangelize, how to evangelize somebody one-on-one. And in that retreat, they have to go around to people, and they have two questions to ask them. The first question is, suppose you were to die, and God were to ask you, why should I give you the gift of eternal life? What would you tell God? Suppose you were to die, and God were to ask you, why should I give you the gift of eternal life? What would you tell God? And it's very frightful that most people, including most Catholics, who are asked that question, do not give a good answer. In other words, most people do not have a good understanding as to how to get to heaven. Now, do we realize when we die, there's only one thing that will matter, where we spend the rest of eternity. That's the only thing that will matter. Not number of trophies, number of doctorates, number of salaries, nothing else will matter when we are judged. Only where we spend the rest of eternity. And eternity is not a long time. Eternity is time without end. That's the only thing that will matter. Therefore, we have to be extremely careful. We know how to face that judgment and come out with the right results. And most people do not know how to prepare for this. They do not know what that judgment will be like. How could that be? How could that be? We spend thousands and thousands of education. All those little children have to go extra lessons just so they can get the right answer. Or get an extra classes together one rather than two. We spend tons of money on education towards us with this salary. And the most important thing we have to do, we forget to do, to understand and then to comply what it is I must do to ensure that my next life is in heaven. The most important question we don't have to answer. I think that a funeral is always an opportunity, more so for the living than the dead. This gentleman, this brother, has run his race, he has fought his fight, he has breasted the team, he is facing his judgment. What about you and myself? Are we ready to face death? If death were to come knocking at our door right now, are you prepared? Am I prepared? When last did you say any kind of prayer of repentance, telling God you're sorry for your sin? The gospel is clear. Whether it is Nicodemus, Jairus, Lydia, asking Jesus or his disciples, what must I do to have eternal life? The answer always began with, repent. Repent. No excuses. Just say to the Lord genuinely, I I am sorry for my life's sins. And I promise, with your help, to fight hard not to sin again. And as often as I fall, I will get up and keep fighting that good fight. I promise, with your help, to fight not to sin again. And to live my life for you, my Lord. How many of us do that in any form or fashion? How many of us think ourselves as good Christians that, you know, we're okay, we just do not have a rule of life, even to obey the first commandment, to find ourselves in our church every weekend to worship the Lord? All kinds of other things get important, and we don't do that. It is not a rule in our lives. There is no excuse. God never gave us 7 days to do what we want. He gave us 6. And instead of our God, he always maintained the Sabbath day for himself. For himself. How do you feel when people go near and come and touch your body? Well, when you touch the Sabbath day and do not give God his due, that is very serious. I pray, God, that this funeral and every funeral will be a sober reminder to all of us who still have the breath of life to ensure we benefit from having attended this funeral and moving forward more conscious and more deliberate in our lives for Christ. Holy Spirit.
And not be swept along by worldliness and sin,
Lord, we pray that we may not be deceiving of ourselves and ensnared and trapped by the wicked works of Satan, but rather we may ensure that we are close to you so that you can protect us and give us the happiness you so want us to have. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all those who grieve and those whose grieving process is very traumatic. Lord, we pray that through all these difficulties, that these may serve to touch these brothers and sisters in their minds and their souls to really make a serious change in their lives that they can always remember happened because of the death of Jesus. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
These are the good intentions. Lord, hear us.
Thank you.
servant James. On his funeral day, we offer you this sacrifice of consolation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to him, or any human fault have affected him, it may by a loving gift be forgiven and wiped away by the Lord.
Amen.
The Lord is you.
Amen.
Lift up your hearts.
Let
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. Our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere we give his hands. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so that we might all escape from dying. As one man he chose to die, so that in your sight we might be all might live forever. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim you. We have been loaded by the life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks to you, God, as worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. How may we be that partaking of the body and blood of Christ? We may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, that you spread from the world and bring unto the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Jesus our Archbishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant James, who with Paul from this world to yourself, grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. And be the blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints, who have pleased you throughout the ages, be remembered to be glorious to eternal life, and in praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever.
Supper of the Lamb.
imagine we have lots of the congregations represented here today. At this time, however, Holy Communion is offered only to practicing Catholics. That too will be understood by those who are practicing Catholics. So if you go, you are committed to receive communion as a Catholic, practicing at least, then we invite you to come forward.
Thank you.
Let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully meet him again. When the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Thank you. was whipped in the park. On the train attendant, right now in the school, then to the train school, where he perfected his craft of goodwill stationery. He is loving up two professions, taxi driver, carpenter slash drawing. Uncle James credited Mr. Bobby Charles, who took him under his charge to perfect his craft. Joinery was definitely his passion, and he did it well. He mirrored peaceful disposition of Granny Myra, where peace was always his portion.
Uncle James had a great heart. When he cared for you, he genuinely did. An active member of this parish, the Sacred Heart of the Catholic Church, up until his illness, which took the better of him. He was part of the active and strong men's group in our parish, and some of these benches that you sit on today, he would have assisted in its refurbishment. As the adults say, the early bird catches the worm, but for discipline, he mastered it from Granny Myra, because she believed we must get up before the sun rises on us so we wouldn't be lazy.
As an early rising before the sun, he did his devotion before he went outside to clean his vehicle, to prepare the day's proceedings. He worked hard as a carpenter and joiner with the junior sample of companies on the Fortin for the Panda Highway projects. Due to his commitment and strong will ethics, by doing what he loved, he would be sent anywhere in Trinidad and Tobago to do a job for the GSCL, an active member of the Southwest Taxi Association, and he represented the library branch well.
He was a great father to his kids, Sasha and Jabari, and would have been an instrumental father figure in the lives of Nikisha, Aaliyah, and Sally's kids. Sally is grateful for his involvement in the kids' lives, which she often said to him. He dressed well and smelled great tea. Any passengers in the house? Show my arms up and give the child an easy love. Just raise your hand. Once Mr. Easy Love on the road, say no more. He never pulled you as the regular taxi drivers in his quiet voice. You know the regular thing? Like one more to go when the car really ends. Go hard at it until you are permissioned with his favorite. He loved football and basketball and was a member of the Larry Giants football team, even playing basketball on the court back in the days with Fortin's coaches, Mr. Patel, Lal, Eagle, Steve, just to name a few. But when he spoke about these games, you would be in stitches. On and off the basketball and football field, he moving easy, easy with the ladies on the sideline. So you understand what we mean when we say easy love. Mr. Easy Loving did it smooth. He was pleasant, free-spirited, loving and kind. A well-kept and groomed man. Respectable, strong, honest, and fully grounded in Christ. These are just a few words to describe the man he was. His regular clients that he did work for at their homes can attest to it. The King's family, Mrs. Valdez, and her family, just to name a few. You can leave your house and come back, nothing will be missing. He was self-motivated, and he believed that with a good mind and clean heart, you can overcome anything. He was repetitive, not because he wanted to, but the value he placed on the things he said. Sasha can attest to this. Sashi, your father doesn't love you. Don't make anybody take advantage. Keep your head up. Take good care of yourself and Zion. Look out for your brother. Jabari, all your daddy wanted is for you to be respectful and to stay out of trouble. Friends does carry up, but they don't ever bring it up. Just as he loved his children, he loved his grandson, nieces, and nephews alike. Once he considered you as a friend, he truly did.
DJ, Tom Tom, HD, Labor, Calipons, with the soldiers. Apologies if we left your name out, but these are what we can go. Sally, we miss dancing, singing, making jokes all the time too, or even having your morning breakfast. Or him checking in on you at your job just to make sure you are alright. A typical Sunday who then go into church, then to the beach for leisure time. Uncle James oftentimes said to Sally, one placed him into his life for a reason. She drew strength from him, for he always remained positive. The simple things he enjoyed, having a good lunch or spending quality time. Sally, we know the plans no one would have made, but God set him to front. Do you have to do?
Love for our family was of paramount importance for him. In the midst of all of his fears and this journey, he remained steadfast and quite frankly optimistic. Never forgetting the word that he said. Cool and humble as a lamb, easygoing was the man. This man loved his family. How he could not eat his favorite meat food. He read slow, that was it. He not stay in Rex.
She could.
He would say, Myra and Elta love peace, so give me food and just hush. Kinda, he loved you so much. Despite the arguments and banter, back and forth you all would know. Whenever he meet me, he would be like, Sister Carrie, I'll be like, yes, Brother James, Brother in Christ. Kidna is my woman and business to her. Once he couldn't get you to her, he would be like, Sister Carrie, talk to me, sister, please. Talk to Shakuna. Kidna always kept him in check. She was blunt with him, and yes, sometimes they would go back and forth. However, their love remained still. Every business plan that he had, he pulled together his three musketeers. Kinda, Anthony, Oboyole, and Sasha. Anyone here working at the Ministry of Labor by chance? So I'm safe to go on. As an employer, he never paid the minimum wage to his employee because all his favorite boy Kyan ever worked for was $1 per shift. He had Kyan right under him in the workshop, any time, any hour, but he only paid the child $1. As Uncle James said to his baby brother, Mackenzie, don't ever give up. When you love what you do, do it to the best of your ability. Uncle Kenty, the torch is now passed to you to keep the family together. I urge you all to stay strong. He used to always stay on top of things and would bother you until it was done. Boy, you have anything for me? Anthony would reply, brother, relax yourself. Nothing was never a problem for him. He did it willingly. In every family, you must have nurses. Unregistered and registered, tending to your sick loved ones. Mommy Denise, Sally, and Sasha, you all have done a wonderful and fantastic job caring for him and making him completely comfortable. To the entire family, your support is appreciated. And from the bottom of our hearts, we say thank you for everything you have done, even being miles away. Uncle James, since you are now heading on your way to meet Granny Myra and Elta, please remember the money Boy gave you to fix the graves so long. It was paid in full, so please complete the job down there, please. To everyone that prayed for him and extended well wishes, we receive it with open arms, and we extend the same to you and to your families. Granny Myra certainly would welcome her friend man, as she called him, to his final resting place. Uncle James, you have run your race and you have done it well in the midst of all of your pain. Your legacy for love of family will live on in all of us because you have touched many lives. Kion will have the workshop for you. As the child already said, he's in charge. Mommy, that means no words can adequately describe what we are all feeling. But Uncle James thanked you immensely on his final bed. And as he said, God will always bless you and keep you. To his siblings, Uncle Sylvester, Uncle Walters, Carl, Jeff, Christine, foreign one, and there was Christine, the local one. But he always said, Christine, the foreign one, she liked to ruin it. She cried overseas, but she wanted to ruin it. Your brother loved each and every one of you. We appreciate all you have done and for simply being here to celebrate in his life today. Today, as we leave, I urge you to take with you Uncle James' love for family. For no one knows, but hold tight and steadfast to Jesus, because God knows best. Sleep well with your Heavenly Father until we meet up on the other side. Love always, easy loving, sleep in peace. Thank you.
James, may the angels lead you to paradise. May the fathers come to welcome you and lead you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham and where Lazarus is born no longer. May you find eternal rest. Go in the peace of God.